Well, let's take our Bibles this morning and turn to the Gospel of Luke. Luke's Gospel, chapter 1. And we'll read from verse 1. Let's hear the Word of God. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, of the division of Abijah. He had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord. But they had no child because Elizabeth was barren, and both were advanced in years. Now, while he was serving as priest before God, when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense. And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great before the Lord. And he must not drink wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, and to make ready for the Lord a people prepared." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So this is the second, of course, Sunday of Advent. Last Sunday we looked in John chapter 1 at John's account of the advent of Jesus. And what John gave us there is, we might call, a God's eye view. In other words, the focus of that chapter was that the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. And John was happy then to leave us with the big picture without going into any details. I have a notion why that may have been. John, we know, cared for Jesus' mother Mary. After the crucifixion, Jesus committed her into John's care, and we know that she went with him and lived in his household when he was pastoring in the church in Ephesus. And it seems as if John cared for Mary until the end of her life. And I think probably out of respect for her, did not want to be the one to tell us more details of this period in her life. Luke, however, wants to fill in the blanks. By this time, Mary is dead, but her account of these early episodes had been kept and cherished by the early church. What we know about Luke is that he was a medical doctor. We see that he had an eye for detail. He very often gives us far more specific detail about illnesses and diseases that Jesus healed, which indicate his interest in those specific things. And he tells us in verse 1 that he had undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that had been accomplished among us. He had an eye for detail. He now wants to put those things together for us. So I have 3 points this morning, and the first one is the source of the story as that we've read here today. These first two chapters of Luke's Gospel, beginning at verse 5, do not sound like Luke. Now, we have a lot of material of Luke to work with. He writes two of the largest books in the New Testament. Luke and Acts are huge books in which we get to understand and see Luke's handling of Greek, which, by the way, is the best handling of anybody else who's writing here, apart from the Apostle Paul, in the New Testament. Luke is a native Greek speaker, and his grasp of Greek is very good indeed. But this text gives very clear signals that there is an underlying Hebrew text from which this section is composed. There are a number of Hebrew expressions that are not typical of Luke's writing. You read everything else that Luke writes, and you discover when you read this, this is different. This has a feel for a different kind of world than the Greek world that Luke is familiar with and writing into. And it, we believe, that Luke's account is following an older Hebrew account that conveys Mary's memories, as well as providing us with scriptural context for the events as they unfolded before the birth of Jesus. And this is probably one of the first big lessons of this chapter, that this story, the story that's being recounted in these opening chapters of Luke, is what makes sense of the rest of Scripture. That these stories, the stories of Jesus, are what interprets and fulfills Scripture in a fundamental way. One scholar says it like this: what the Scriptures intended to say in many passages becomes visible only now through this new story. This new story makes sense of something that has lain deep in Scripture, but has not really been recognizable until Christ comes and provides the full meaning and weight, the divinely intended meaning of Scripture. So the story of the gospel, which begins with the incarnation and culminates with the cross and resurrection of Jesus, is the reality towards which the Scriptures were always moving and to which the Scriptures were always referring. Now, we know that Mary, the mother of our Lord, was very concerned about the issues as they unfolded. For example, in Luke chapter 2, we read this, that she treasured these things up in her heart. That is, meaning the shepherd's visit, the angels singing, and so on. She pondered them in her heart. When the angel came to her, a little later on, recorded in verse 26 of this chapter, when the angel comes to her and announces, he greets her and then announces the great event that is going to unfold, we're told that she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. We learn something about Mary in the comments, the passing comments that Luke gives us about her response. One of the things we learn about her is that she was a thoughtful, intelligent, godly woman who understood the Scripture. And she's not just scared by the angel, she's a bit feisty actually, by the angel coming to her compared to other people, but she is troubled by what the angel says, and she begins to think it through. She begins to think about what's being said to her, and tries to find, even as the angel is talking to her, some categories from her knowledge of Scripture into which she can put the things that are being said. We find it later on when Jesus is 12 years of age. Luke records this story. When Jesus goes AWOL, as the family are going back from Jerusalem back to Nazareth where they live, they can't find him. They go back to Jerusalem and they go into the temple, and there he is sitting at 12 years of age with the theologians around them, engaging them in questions. And Joseph and Mary kind of forget who he is, if you like, and they do what parents usually do. They give him into trouble. And he responds to them, "I must be about my Father's house." And we're told that Mary treasured up all these things in her heart. In other words, Mary has intentionally try to remember the details of what occurred because she understands the significance, the unprecedented significance of the events as they are unfolding. And where she goes for her understanding is to the scriptures, as any godly person would do. One scholar talks about in the Old Testament scripture there being waiting words, W-A-I-T, waiting words. That is, waiting until their owner turns up. And you will find plenty of these references to waiting words in the New Testament that are interpreted in light of their owner once Jesus has come onto the scene. So the source of the story is Mary, the mother of our Lord. The setting of the story is spelled out for us there in verse 5. It was the days of Herod, king of Judea. There was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Luke is saying to us, these stories I'm about to tell you do not belong to the genre of myth or legend. These stories are not a theological construct. Even though there are some supernatural things, the miracle of conception, two miracles of conception in these stories, these were real people. They belong to a particular place and to a particular time. And these people were eyewitnesses to an intervention of God in history. Now, we need to remind ourselves constantly, don't we, that God is not a creature. As creatures, we can only be at one place in history at one time. We are bounded by time and space. We can only be in one space, so if you're in this room, I know some of you look as if you're not in this room, and I need your attention back here, but if you're in this room, you're in the same place as I am. We can only be in one place at one time. And we can only exist in one period of time because we are earthbound creatures. God is not confined by time or space. To God, time and space are all one thing in his gaze, as it were. He's created time and space. Everything that happens, he has ordered and foreordained will happen. And it all appears to God in one nanosecond of time, to his knowledge. Everything is alive to his knowledge at one and the same time. But that does not mean that God is not involved in the world sustaining it, and that when God begins to do things in the world, what to him is the same moment is to us who are time-bound an action that takes place in the flow of history. This is what is being described in these verses. God is acting in history. What is one action to him without any movement on his part is to us who are looking on within time something in the flow of human events. So the historical connection, the personal context. Before we come to look at these two people more closely, I want you to notice that both these people, Zechariah and Elizabeth, came from priestly stock. Zechariah, we read, is from the division of Abijah, Elizabeth from the daughters of Aaron. Both of those are priestly families within the tribe of Levi. When God brought the 12 tribes of Israel out of Egypt, he appointed the tribe of Levi to be a tribe of priests. That was their job. That was their reason for existence. They were the priests. They were supported by all the other 11 tribes so that they could exist to serve God in the temple and its environs and to serve the people of God as priests. And these two people came from priestly backgrounds. So the people of their day would imagine that this union of Elizabeth and Zechariah was an ideal union. They were two priestly families marrying together. Kind of thing that people say when somebody is a minister's daughter and they marry somebody who is a minister's son. They can share the misery together in that sense. Now, Judah had lots of priests, a whole tribe of people to be priests. There was loads of priests. There was an overkill of priests within Judah. But there was only one place where a priest could actually operate as a priest, and that is in the temple. And there was only one temple, and it had finite space. So what they did was they had divided up the tribe of Levi into divisions, and each division got a shot at doing the work around the temple. That's the reference to the division of Abijah, and Zechariah belonged to that particular division. We're told more about them. We're told that Elizabeth and Zechariah were a godly couple. They were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord. Those are Hebrew expressions. These are the typical expressions you find all through the Old Testament, describing the deep religious piety of people who lived their lives coram Deo before God, in the face of God. This specific word, righteous, in Hebrew has a legal meaning. It means to be right with God. They were right with God, in a right relationship and standing with God. And they were blameless. Now, you mustn't think for one minute when you read the word blameless, after King David was blameless, but he was not sinful. Blameless does not mean absolutely perfect. For example, the Apostle Paul, when he's describing his pre-converted life before he became a Christian, while he was still persecuting and destroying the church of God, he says about his life back there, he says that he was blameless with respect to the law of God. So blameless, if you like, is relative. But it means, by and large, the direction of a person's life is a Godward direction. Godward direction. So these two words then, bring them together, we discover that Zechariah and Elizabeth were in a right relationship with God. Their lives were going in the right direction. They were earnest and pious souls. Their religion was right religion. It consisted of two parts. Their religion was both formal and outward, and personal and inward. Very often the word religion is castigated by evangelicals. It's become the buzz word that religion is a bad thing. And usually religion is caricatured as something that is external and formal. But actually, real religion is external and formal. The external and formal aspect of religion is what people see. What we are doing in church on Sunday mornings is we are fulfilling the external and formal aspect of our religion. We are going public in our worship of God, in our praise of God, in our submission to the Word of God, in our enjoyment of the sacraments when we have them. That aspect of religion is vital. It is the outward sign that we are, in fact, the worshipers of God. External and formal. But that is also joined to religion that is internal and personal. And these people had both of those things together. But they have this tragedy in their lives. Look at verse 7. They had no child because Elizabeth was barren and both were advanced in years. That's the punchline. That really is the point that we have to pause on. It's this that has its effect on the Advent. It raises a question. Can an elderly couple, one of whom the woman in the marriage was barren, and now they're old, they're decrepit, to use a word one of the Puritan writers says about them, can a decrepit, barren couple against all nature, become parents? A similar question is going to arise later on in chapter 1 of Luke's gospel. It's the question that comes from the lips of Mary herself: how can this be since I'm a virgin? And the story of our salvation is tied up with those two questions. Something supernatural will be required in both cases. The miracles are quite different in magnitude, but both are necessary for our redemption. Well, that brings us then to the subject of the story. And the subject of the story is this miracle of conception in Elizabeth's womb. I said that they were both old. The indication is that they were really old. There was no retirement for priests, just as there used to be no retirement for ministers either, because you were supposed to die on the job. Be warned. So they were really old, and there's this miracle that takes place. So it's a visible thing. Everybody sees this happening. It's well known. It's going to be well known. But I want you to notice the first moves begin in the temple. I've explained about the divisions of the temple. It was Zechariah had spent most of his life, probably most of his life as a priest, and he'd never worked in the temple. You can imagine his excitement when he discovers that this year, his division, the division of Abijah, is going to be working in the temple. That was random, but it was a good thing. But more than that, just because you were in the division of Abijah and they were responsible for the temple did not mean that you actually ever got to do anything in the actual sanctuary itself. There are all kinds of jobs that priests got. There was a job of the guys at the gate of the temple, and people are bringing their sacrifices, and his job is to examine the animal, examine the birds, make sure that they don't have any defects, because you can't offer an animal or a bird to God and sacrifice that had a defect. The guy's checking them out, and so on. That's not the job you really want, but somebody has to do that job, and people in the division of Abijah would be doing that job. So who gets to go into the temple, into the sanctuary? Well, they cast lots, and so it says here, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. That was one of the top jobs. He wasn't the high priest, so he couldn't go into the Holy of Holies, but he could go into the holy place. Temple was divided up. There was the Holy of Holies, the Sanctum Sanctorum, Holy of Holies, where only the high priest once a year got to go. Then outside of that, there is the holy place. The holy place has a small altar where the incense was thrown to burn and to create the smoke of incense that would rise up towards heaven. In that holy place, there was also the seven-branch candlestick. And that's the place where he was chosen by lot to go into the temple of the Lord and to burn incense there in the holy place. And then outside the holy place, there was the court of the people. The people are gathered there. And while he's inside, he could hear the prayers of the people as they prayed. Everybody was praying their own prayers all together, shouting out their prayers to God. It was a cacophony of noise outside with people praying while he's in there, representing the people before God. And he did this by burning incense on the altar. And the fragrance of the incense was a symbol of the prayers of the people. The psalmist had said in Psalm 141, "Let my prayer be counted as incense before you, and the lifting up of my hands as an evening sacrifice." So it was part of the formal worship of Israel. We discover in Revelation chapter 5 that it's part of the formal liturgy of heaven. The four living creatures, the 24 elders, were holding harps and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. The sweet-smelling incense that rises up to God, that pleases God. That's the picture language of Revelation. That pleases God are the prayers of the saints. So Zechariah then is in there. He's at the altar. He has the incense. He's throwing it onto the altar. It burns, and as it burns, the fragrance is given off, and the fragrance is rising. The place is becoming thick with the fragrance of the incense. Bits of it are escaping. The people outside begin to think, "Oh, I could smell the incense." We can smell that the priest is in there and he's offering the incense up to God. So here are we praying, and there's the symbol of our prayers. God is pleased with our prayers. God is accepting our prayers. God is listening to our prayers. The visual smoke, the smell, the senses, and the prayers of the people, what they're hearing around them as well as what they're offering to God, so all combine in this mysterious action. And that priest is representing the people as he offers up incense to God. He's representing their prayers. And it was at that moment, this high and holy moment, that there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense, that is, between the altar and the seven-branched candlestick that represented all of Israel itself. In a place and at a time that is the most holy moment, we have the very first movement towards the coming of the Messiah himself. The events of the cross and the resurrection are initiated at this holy moment. And at this moment, there is a continuity with everything that is past, which is why it happens in the temple. It happens in the temple so that you realize this is where the story was going all along, that there is a connection between what God calling his people out of Israel, God creating the tabernacle and then the temple, and the whole ceremony of temple worship. It's all now coming to its fulfillment. It's about to arrive at its end, not so much at its end in ceasing to be, but its purpose. In this holy place and this holy time, while the prayers of Israel are being offered, the angel of the Lord visits him. And Zechariah is troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. You know, that's a very strange comment. This was the most holy moment of his life. This was him doing his job for the very first time, representing Israel, offering up the prayers of incense to God. He believed that when he was in church, like you believe when you're in church, God is here, he is present with you. He believed that too. But when the angel of the Lord appeared, he was terrified. He was terrified. And nothing really had changed. You understand this? Nothing had really changed. The Lord was there. He should have been terrified before he saw the angel of the Lord, that the Lord was there. You don't want the angel of the Lord to appear in 10th this morning. Seriously. Some of you would have heart attacks. We'd have to do all kinds of triage in order to sort you out. Angels of the Lord terrify people. Wherever they appear, they terrify people. Because no matter how much we believe we're in the presence of the Lord, we don't really believe it. We don't really believe it. Until an angel comes and turns up and scares the living daylights out of us, we don't really believe it. And Zechariah is in that category. And the angel spoke. "Don't be afraid," he says, "Zechariah, for your prayers have been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will call his name John." And the specific prayer of Zechariah had been heard. But what God is saying to Zechariah and to us is this: as God says to Zechariah, your specific prayer has been heard, You're not a private person. You're in the holy place. You're representing all Israel. And just as your prayer has been heard, and you will have a son, and you'll call him John, the prayer of Israel has been heard, and God is going to intervene. It was a promise of the intervention of God. And so when the angel says your prayer has been heard, he is placing this new step, this moment, this new movement in the purposes of God in the context of what God has been doing throughout history. Here you are, you're old, your wife is barren, you're going to have a son. Who does that remind you of? Zechariah, Abram, and Sarai. When the Lord comes and he says, I will surely return to you in the spring, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son. Meanwhile, Sarah's behind the curtain listening, and she starts to laugh. She thought quietly to herself. And the Lord says, why did Sarah laugh? Is anything too hard for the Lord? Or the story of Hannah and her son Samuel, who is a gift of God and is devoted to the Lord. Here is a confluence of influences from the past now coming to a head. This is the last such incident there will be in Scripture. But it's part of a continuity. And you will call his name John, which means Yahweh shows grace. His name points to the future, to the work of the Lord who is coming, who is going to show grace to his people by sending the Messiah. And the angel says the coming of John will bring joy and gladness to you, but also to other people. Many will rejoice at his birth. The language there is jubilant language, a shout of joy. Joy that bubbles over and can't contain itself. This will be where the sharing of joy, this will be more than just the sharing of joy by the parents. It will be joy of what he has come to do. What has he come to do? He will be great before the Lord. That's true greatness, isn't it? What a person is before God when they're on their own and no one is looking. That is what they are and no more. He'd be great in the eyes of the Lord. John the Baptist has a unique place in all of biblical history. It's John the Baptist, as he's baptizing Jesus, who has the first revelation of the Holy Trinity, as he has in his hands God in the flesh. He sees God in a dove descending on Jesus and hears God with a voice saying, you are my beloved son. John the Baptist will be marked out. He'll be marked out by one distinguishing mark from all the other priests and prophets and even Jesus himself, because it says that he will not drink wine and strong drink. That was not a forbidden item for the priests, by the way. It was only forbidden when they were in the sanctuary. The Lord Jesus, when he came, because he is the sanctuary and he is the final temple, he didn't bother with that when that didn't apply to him. It would be a distinctive thing for anybody not to drink wine or strong drink. It was what distinguished him from everybody else and marked him out as being different from everybody else. Early this morning, I read John Calvin, who's a bit threatened by this statement, and he says, please be careful to notice that the Luke is not making this a virtue, not drinking wine and strong drink. He's not making it a virtue. He's not saying, y'all can't do this. He's saying, John is marked out by the fact that he's the only person who isn't. That's what he's saying. At least that's what John Calvin said. All right. You can take, maybe argue that with him when you see him in heaven. But he'll also be distinguished by the fact that he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. The whole point is that this John, you see, has a once in the history of the world mission. A one-off. There's going to be nobody like John the Baptist. The whole of his life is going to be lived as if he's working in the sanctuary, in the holy place. People will notice that. His whole life is spent preparing the way of the Lord. And there are some texts that come together here. And as you read these words, these are the texts from which the words are coming. Malachi, the prophet Malachi, very last prophet in the Old Testament. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. And again, the same chapter, chapter 3 of Malachi. Behold, I send my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come into his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. Now, Malachi was not saying that Elijah will actually himself be raised from the dead and come back. And it says here in the text that John the Baptist will come, in verse 17, in the spirit and power of Elijah. But the point is that he is coming with a specific purpose: to prepare God's people for the Lord coming. Jesus once said about John that he was more than a prophet, because he fulfilled Malachi chapter 3 prophecy. How was he more than a prophet? Well, all the prophets had prophesied the coming of the Messiah. From Moses right through to Malachi, they had prophesied that the Messiah was coming. John's job was different. John's job was to tell people the Messiah has already come. And John's job was to actually point out who the Messiah was. That's what made him greater than all the other prophets. And that's what John does. He points Jesus out to the people. He tells them about Jesus, that he was before him, that is, eternally before him. And he identifies Jesus as the Lord who has come to thoroughly cleanse the temple. John's role was to prepare Israel for this unprecedented event, and to tell Israel that whereas God in the old covenant was present in the temple, in the new covenant, God is now present in Jesus. Well, there's another reference here to the book of Daniel, when Gabriel identifies himself in verse 19. I'm Gabriel, I stand in the presence of God. That comes from the book of Daniel, where Daniel is given a timetable. And if you follow the timetable Daniel is given, if you work it out in terms of the years that are predicted and so on, they kind of end right here where the angel is speaking to Zechariah. And Daniel says that is the moment when God will bring everlasting righteousness. A righteousness that can be counted towards you. The righteousness of God that's now available through faith in Jesus Christ to everybody who believes. I said that John was descended from a mother and father who were both members of the priestly tribe. Do you know what that says about John? It says that John was a priest. Says that one of John's jobs as a priest was the job I was describing earlier on, when the priest is checking out the lambs that are being brought for sacrifice, during the Passover period? Are they without defect? Are they perfect? And it's John the priest, down by the River Jordan, who points our attention to Jesus and says, "Behold the Lamb of God. There's the perfect Lamb. There's the Lamb for sacrifice. There's the Lamb whose death will cleanse us all from our sin and reconcile us all to God. There's the Lamb who will bring the perfect Passover and usher us into the presence, the eternal presence of God." John's work was to point out Jesus, and it was to point to Jesus and say, "The Lord, i.e. the God of Israel, has come. As he used to come to the temple and to the Holy of Holies, he now resides in Jesus, the Holy of Holies. And in Jesus will offer up the sacrifice that will bring us to God." Let's pray together. Father, we pray that as we consider these things, these great events that prepared our understanding for the arrival of Jesus and who he is and what he's come to do, we pray that you would excite our expectations once again as we contemplate this time of year that is the most theologically rich time of year in the Christian calendar, as we consider what you have done in Christ for the salvation of men and women. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.